sorry to make you seasick by filing through this so quickly. Oh, there we go. Go back here. This is only one. So this is from Take This Fruit Is My Body. Did you experience Take This Fruit Is My Body?
I only saw it in relation to the comment space.
You saw it, yeah. I did it in Bristol as well, and I did it twice in performance space.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe you should talk about it, because I'll waffle on.
Well, I never got to sit down and actually...
You never got a scone?
No, I never got a scone.
Oh, no.
So, I think...
You never got a scone. Okay.
Not a scone.
That sounds like a total non sequitur if you don't know what the work is. Basically, I make scones. So I offer the audience, I invite them to join me for afternoon tea. And I make a batch of scones, which I serve with jam and cream and tea, and I serve them all to the audience. What they are told beforehand is that they agree to either accept or decline that offering in the knowledge that the scone batter contains about 7 mils of my blood. That the process of making the scones is part of the live piece as well. People watch me making the scones and pouring in the blood. This is from the very first presentation of the work, which actually was in the UK at Nullarfini at In Between Time in 2010. So that action is performative. The scones don't just appear. We're missing an image. Oh no, we're not. I've just gone the wrong way. There we go. So this is me and an audience member serving the scones. So people sit down, and originally it was a one-to-one. I now do it as a performance for small groups. So I'm forgetting another presentation of it actually, which was in the cellars of Elizabeth Bay House, which is one of my favorite iterations of this work, because it was such a resonant historical site. So what happens when people sit down at the table is that this very kind of interesting series of micro-relations start to unfold between the people who are sitting at that table. And you know, the question that people usually ask me is like, so do people eat the scones? And the answer is most people do. But it depends who's sitting there, because people influence each other. It's this really kind of quite fascinating psychological experiment to observe.
With the one-to-one, did anyone not refuse a scone?
One person did, but it was because they were gluten intolerant. And they told me later and apologised.
Yeah, so that's really interesting, isn't it, in terms of like, yeah, you know, this one-to-one. They were gluten-free. But but yeah, I like that idea, you know, as soon as you introduce another person, right?
They start to spark off each other. I've got a lot of stories about this work and the weirdness that I've observed at that table. It's super interesting to me, because this is a work about how we deal with history. So it's a work about, first of all, about assimilation, about this idea of assimilation and of contamination, and questions around blood as they relate to my own heritage, and the history of racial assimilation in this country.
And how we digest that.
How we digest it, literally. And our choice to live with difficult histories, or, you know. And so people tend to sit and contemplate that when they get that scone put in front of them.
And in the big presentation of Unsettling Sweet at Performance Space, which was the video that you all just saw. I mean, it was the room was so incredibly, you know, evocative as well in that space as well. Did you have an old Waratah oven there?
Yeah, there was this old cast iron stove that we had in there. I don't have a. You can see it in the video. You might have seen it briefly, but I don't have a photograph of it. Yeah, it was an old working think it was an Adelaide stove, actually, like 1930s cast iron stove. So the whole thing was kind of, the whole installation was made to resemble kind of a farmhouse, yeah, really, and was very much kind of evoking a certain era.
Whereas scones were very, very important.
Yeah, where scones were very important, and racial assimilation was very important, and a bunch of other stuff was going on, and sort of thinking about particularly generations of Aboriginal women in domestic service in Australia and all this kind of stuff, but also engaging ideas around the Gothic and around the idea of the house as this kind of theatre for the return of the repressed and, you know, for kind of cultural hauntings, I suppose. I also set out on making this work by thinking about sort of domestic substances, like the sort of the substances of our everyday lives. So I started making, take this food as my body, because I was thinking about flour. So I was thinking about, I think it was, what was the list? It was like flour, sugar, cotton, meat. Those are the main ones. So thinking about the things that we all have in our kitchens that are kind of intimate to us, but which also have a very direct relationship to the dispossession of Indigenous peoples from their lands because of agricultural production in Australia. So there's a lot of layers to unsettling this week, and we're not going to get to even touch on them here, because we need to probably move on to the next, or another piece within the unsettling this week.
Yeah, well, I'm thinking, like, a nice segue from this one, because we're talking about the blood in the scones, is then to talk about the crockery.
Heirloom. Okay, so I think that's the next one. Oh, no, it's just the wrong way again.
Incredibly. How long did that take to make?
That took about 3 months. Here we go. So this is a work called Heirloom, which was just, not everyone even noticed it in the space, to be honest. It was just on the dresser in the kitchen, and you had to kind of walk past it to go into the next room. And it's a full dinner set. It's like 8 plates, a soup tureen, a big platter. All of them are kind of intricately painted with the willow pattern. But the medium is my blood, mixed with a glass painting, a sort of glass painting varnish medium, which set it and set the colour and set the texture as it dried.
And I think it's so evocative too, because again, when you're looking at this colonial thing, like the willow pattern, this sort of coming out from England with your dinner sets, and this, you know, it was such an important part, and you know, to be transporting that sort of I suppose history to here, and then it gets handed down, and then they were so exquisite, like, to see, you know. And I think that this is just it, that I think it's interesting that people didn't notice at some point of them, because it is almost like they're so not commonplace, but we understand that symbol so much that maybe it's sort of like, oh yeah, that's that. But then to look at them much closer, it's sort of like, there's almost like this sickening feeling that you have when you really sort of look at the detail of these works. And
yeah, I like that, because it wasn't like anything was labelled in the space. It didn't have a plaque next to it saying this is an artwork and this is human blood. You just, if you kind of like took the time to look at it a little bit more closely, you would figure out what it was and have that moment of kind of queasiness or recognition or whatever. And I really like that kind of discretion and surprise, you know. So yeah.
So then it's just,
talk about, just to touch on corpus
callidus. Yes. Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say.
So back in time. Oops. Too far back in time. Okay, so this is a work called corpus callidus. There's a close-up of those skins again, and of that that dress, which is kind of cast in resin. So just reminding you, like, when people came into this space, there was an overpowering smell of sheep.
Or
of dead sheep. Yeah.
Really meaty.
It was
really
very meaty.
Bloody and, yeah. Really pungent, really got into your nose.
And a very nostalgic smell. Very, like, super olfactory. Packs an olfactory punch, that one.
Yeah, and if you've ever been
Yeah.
I was thinking, if you've ever been in a sheep shed,
yeah,
that's exactly, it smells like a shearing shed. It's exactly what it smells like.
Yeah.
It's like that sort of slaughterhouse, but sheep shearing.
Yeah. Here's me with my equally woolly head of hair, beginning the performance. So I kind of approach the dressing table naked, and I then start this process of piercing the word nauleous into my chest. So I'm sure everyone in this room is familiar with the legal fiction that is terra nullius. So I transfer the word onto my chest with this tattoo transfer paper, and I have needles here, which I then pierce the word nauleous into my chest. This has become quite a well-known image.
I was just about to say, and this is sort of the iconic image, isn't it?
It's the hero.
Yeah.
It's the hero image. It's it was mainly because it was that real-time cover.
Mm.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's such an incredible, like, image too. I mean, I think it's sort of, you know, it comes from this sort of chamber of complete, you know, stage within this chamber of complete anguish and sort of trauma and endurance and but yet we were, you know, Sarah Jane and I were talking about the other night about, like, this sort of, again, this sort of idea of documentation and how it works and why we need it and things like this, but also, like, so much of the work that we both make, but Sarah Jane makes, that it's so not about the document, like, the documentation is held in other ways. And we were discussing how this one is so interesting because this work actually has only been performed twice, but this image is the most published image.
Yeah.
And yet something like Rest Area, that is, like, probably the most, you know, performed it well over 10 times.
Yeah.
You know, there is no sort of real, you know, highly published image from that. So it's just a really interesting sort of, when we talk about that stuff, it's really interesting.
Yeah, I find it a real trip, to be honest, that this image is so everywhere and is so kind of representative for people of my practice. But the work itself has only been performed twice and seen by maybe 12 people, you know,
and
max.
Yeah, it's this weird sort of double mind that I think that artists get involved in, and, you know, like, and I think it sort of also reminds me, we talked about this too the other night, that it sort of reminds me a bit like the Franco B's I Miss You work, you know, like, it's his work is just that particular piece where he's walking down the sort of white runway and he's, you know, he's bleeding onto the walkway as he walks back and forward. I mean, you know, he talks about that as you know, after he did that work, which was made for a very particular, you know, time and context, and in response to a very particular context, very similarly, you know. And yet, years and years and years and years later, like, when he's, you know, he's an artist of many talents and many works and many investigations, and he's making new work. This is the work that curators or venues or people would want when he's well and truly moved on. So it's sort of like this really sort of weird double bind that is sort of happening around these sort of very, very sort of iconic and beautiful images, but, you know, it's also, when you're a performance maker, it's very much still about the work.
Yeah, yeah,
at
absolutely.
That time and
yeah.
What's happening for you at the time.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, this the funny one about this, though, the funny thing about this image is nobody books this work. Everyone knows this image, but nobody books this work. That's why I've only ever done it twice. Not because it's not a good work, it's a beautiful work. And the people who have seen it have had you know, very strong experiences with this work. I enjoy performing it. but it just hasn't had its moment. And it's like its moment is this image, to be honest, you know, in this weird way.
Yeah, and then I think that the other interesting thing about this is that, so the other part of this is the
embroidery. So I do that first, and then I sit down and embroider this sheep's hide. Oh, goodness. No.
And this just sort of reminds me a little bit of what Marina said the other day when you know, I can see it's easy to cut yourself, but to sit still for a very long time is actually really quite painful. And I think, not that this is similar, but I just think there's a sort of similar binary thing happening here where, you know, people look at that image of you with the pins into your chest and they think of the blood and the piercing and the body and they go, whoa, but in actual fact, the most painful
sitting there doing that embroidery
was doing this, because that is a really, really thick sheep's hide. And you know, I know your fingers were probably bleeding from it. It was really, really painful to do, and it took a very, very long time.
Yes.
So, and yet people would like pass.
People know, get super fixated on the needles, which I find kind of quite amusing, because those are 23 gauge sharps. Like, if you're someone who's into piercing, if you're a piercing pig, it's like nothing. It's totally vanilla. It's like super vanilla, you know. Like, it just is. It's just like, you want to see some piercing? I'll show you some piercing. Like, this is not piercing. This is just nice, you know. But it's more about the way those needles are used and the way that I use those needles, not because they're needles, but because I'm doing something very specific with them in terms of the image. But yeah, people get super fixated on the needles, but the needles are really nothing. You know, it's true what you say. The agonizing part is the embroidery. Because that is a fresh sheep's hide. It's dripping blood. It's slippery. It stinks, and it's very thick. But no one notices that, and no one kind of really thinks about the kind of pain of sitting there for, you know, I think 5 hours is maybe 4 or 5 hours is the longest I've done this piece for.
And how long did it actually take to embroider the whole? Work.
I don't think I actually finished it in the end. I think the show closed and I didn't get to finish it. As much kind of time as I bloody mindedly gave to that task, it was just this Sisyphean, unfinished thing, you know. So, yeah. So I think we're going to take a quick break because we've been here for an hour and then we're going to come back and watch some movies.
Great.
Right. I'm just going to leave you with that image because this is the next work we're going to talk about. This is Bone Library. Let's have a quick loo break. What do you reckon?
Yep, loo break.
Ms. Vulcan, here we are again.
Here we are again, Sarah Jane.
Let's get going.
All right.
Bone Library.
Bone Library. Let's do it.
Let's do it. So, this is, rather than talk about this work, we are just going to screen two short documentaries, or one of them is a 5-minute doco about the work from when I presented it last year at Spill Festival in the UK. The next one is an interview between myself and Heather Castles, who is a really, if you don't know Heather's practice, then you should Google it because they're amazing, like totally amazing. And so it's an interview between me and Castles talking about Bone Library. So I think we just cue the video and go for it. Let's do it. Are we able to bring the lights down on the stage? No? Actually, we can just segue straight on the
Oh, they're here for a second. Because I think actually we are going to have to segue straight.
We're going to have to segue straight. What time are we at now?
We're at 20 to 7.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Crazy.
So, but as we sort of segueing into the next one, I'm just going to pick up on something that Kessel said, which I think is really interesting, is that so Sarah Jane and I were both at the Venice Performance Art Week, and when I was at the handover ritual for, I sort of went to get my bone, and I've seen this work at Next Wave in Melbourne and in Sydney, but here I am getting my bone in Venice. And the first thing I was arguing was, how am I going to get this through customs? And then the irony of it, the irony of taking this bone back to Australia, and how am I going to get it through customs? Anyway, just a little aside. Let's go straight into concerto.
Let's go straight into concerto number three. So before we go into the video, this work needs a little bit of a preamble. So this is my most recent piece of work. It is quite some departure from Bone Library. This work is part of a series which I'm kind of loosely calling the Post-Virtuosity series. That's not its actual title, that's just what I'm calling it in my brain while I make it. So I'm working loosely around this notion of post-virtuosity. So I'm kind of interested in people who, or the experience of people who have trained in a classical discipline and then quit for whatever reason. So to really summarize it, this is a 12-hour performance of Rachmaninoff's the Piano Concerto. So if anyone knows about the Rack 3 is a piece of music that has a really fearsome reputation for destroying pianists. It's the one that Shine was made about. I'm sure many of you will have seen Shine, but it was legendarily was the piece that David Helfgott was trying to master when he had his nervous breakdown. And there are a lot of pianists who refuse to play the Rack 3 because it is technically almost impossible. Even Joseph Hoffman, who was the pianist to whom the work was actually dedicated, refused to play it publicly. So it's this fiercely difficult piece. I kind of wanted to set this group of pianists the totally quixotic task of playing it from sight. So I put a call out through the Conservatorium of Music and through various other channels to find a group of six pianists who self-identified as failed concert pianists. So people who had trained for concert, for classical concert performance, and for whatever reason had quit. And they all agreed to undertake this task. So every pianist played a 2-hour shift at the piano. I also played myself. In the first iteration of the piece, which is in Melbourne. And over the course of the 12 hours, we work our way through the whole score. It's this mammoth score. And it takes 12 hours to get through it. The pianists they've made a commitment to not look at or practice the music beforehand. So they play it completely from sight. The only constraint that they have to work, or the only freedom rather that they have to work with, is that they disregard the note values and the time signature. So they can play it as fast or as slow as they like. So from that, we'll roll to the video. Can we bring the lights down?
Especially in terms of lineage and inheritance, and I sort of like to think about this as sort of like the inheritance. inheritance of expectation, and especially like that expectation that we inherit from our family or our parents or our peers. And for me personally, this speaks to me because I'm the daughter of a piano teacher. And my mother is 75 and still teaching the piano. And so I had to practice the piano every day from the age of 6 till basically 17 or 18 when I left home. And I'm the eldest daughter, so there was a lot of expectation there. So I feel like I'm a little bit of a failed concert pianist.
Never was. It's definitely about, it's a work about, you know, what comes in to occupy the space of unfulfilled expectations. I really love doing this work because the pianists are so amazing. And they have all signed up for this. They've all signed up for this thing that they know is going to be agonizing for them, because sight reading is agonizing at the best of times. And they also have, you know, this kind of inheritance of you know, they're carrying their own personal trauma and history to this work, which is why they're drawn to it and why they want to do it. And a lot of the time, you know, the people that are approaching me are not performance art literate, they're classical musicians, we're not from the same world. But they're just like, I don't know why, but I have this compulsion to do this, and I'm going to do it. And it's really like an exorcism. I don't use that word lightly. Watching these people play is amazing. You don't get any real sense of it from the video. And particularly over this long duration of 12 hours, during which audience can come and go at their leisure. You know, people, they go out there and they're absolutely, the pianists are absolutely petrified when they go onto the stage. And so I have to kind of hold this space for them to get them out there. And then they each play a 2-hour shift, so they play without a break for 2 hours. And they come off absolutely buzzing, totally buzzing. It's beautiful. You know, I've had the most like amazing interactions with people in the dressing room with these guys when they've come off and they've just been in tears and just beaming and just going like, oh my God, I just got to take out my revenge on 16 years of classical music training, you know, and it just pours out of them, you know, but it pours into the performance as well. And I'm in the space with them for the whole 12 hours as well. And it's just like, you kind of like watch these tensions in their bodies. And it really is, you know, one of the people who reviewed this work, Jana Perkovic, said that she compared it to an improvisational dance performance. She really talked about this work in terms of dance, which I thought was super interesting because it's about watching their bodies and the sort of waves of tension and release that move through their bodies as they kind of tackle this very delicate but very intense task. And what happens to the music is beautiful as well, because you kind of, if you know the concerto, you can kind of sit there and listen to it, and every now and again, like, familiar refrains of the music will come through and you'll kind of catch this part that you can recognize. And then it fades again and it just becomes this jumble of notes, because they'll get into another really, really hard part of the score where they're having to kind of like inch out one note after the other, one finger after the other, and it just collapses again. So it does this like kind of wonderful undulation between readability and unreadability. And I also have like never had such a profound kind of durational commitment from audiences before than when I've done this work. It was kind of, when I did it, I've done it twice now. I did it once in Melbourne and once in Birmingham at Fierce Festival. And both times I was just, I was floored by the investment of audiences. Because I can see people coming and going in the space, and people stayed in there for like 4 hours without a break. You know, like that's major. For me, that's major. I mean, with Bone Library, people come back, and the same with Unsettling Suite, you know, but it was like, people came up to me and just said, you know, I came here and I expected to stay for 3 minutes because I thought it was going to be this agonizing thing to watch, but it's really beautiful and it's really mesmerizing, and I just cancelled my whole afternoon and stayed, which was totally remarkable for me, like really humbling that people gave this work that much time.
I think it also speaks to that thing that we all understand, that notion of failure and the responsibility to not fail sometimes that we put on ourselves, and then to be able to sort of witness what comes out of that, you know. And when you say this about these penis being petrified, I mean, if anyone doesn't know, but when you train, when you do the ADV, which is all the levels of piano, when you train, I mean, you know, it's all about you learn this music, you just play it over and over for a year. Like each year you do a different grade and you play however many pieces you've got to learn that year, and you play it over and over and over until you can memorize it. And really, you know, when I moved away from my piano training, it was like I was actually really angry because I felt like I'd had all these years of training, but I couldn't sit down at a piano and just play.
Yeah.
You know, I needed to have a music and I needed to practice the music so it was perfect before I could play. And so it's actually like a really crippling thing. And I think that this, it's just so incredibly, I can only imagine the sort of the liberation and the sort of redemption and like so many things sort of being played out here. And it's quite extraordinary.
Yeah, I love this work. This image that we have is on the screen is a woman called Sayako, who was one of the pianists in Melbourne, and she was completely gorgeous and she played so beautifully. And she came into the dressing room, we had this long conversation when she came off about exactly that. She was just like, you don't understand what you've just given me. She's like, I had to play Rachmaninoff as part of my exams. You know, I had to play this piece for real. And it's all about perfection. It's all about being classical music is about being perfect and interpreting somebody else's work perfectly, you know. But you've just given me the opportunity to play Rachmaninoff badly, and that was amazing, you know, because in playing it badly, it became hers, and she got to like just take that music and in the kind of plasticity of this task, take it and claim it. And she really kind of improvised with it. She put her whole soul and presence into playing that music, but playing it herself, you know, without any expectations. It was really beautiful. Okay. On that note. That's
such a gorgeous way to end.
Yeah, I'm kind of gutted because I had planned to screen another film. Which is a film which is really important to me, which is on another subject. I wanted to screen it because it's a film about pain, but it's about pain specifically within the context of BDSM relationships and kind of transform. Oh, we can't screen it because we don't have time. Can we play it? Don't we have to get everyone out of the building? We're going to get in trouble? It's 15 minutes. It's not my call. Did you say yes? Ah!
Great.
Yes! Okay. Wait. Right. Pause. Because we need to preamble this. Because this is like a total jump cut. Yeah. From what we've been talking about.
So we just do need to say we've been given a very nice little sort of extension here, but it does mean we do have to leave.
Yeah, we totally
so
have to be out.
Might need to be outside.
Yeah, or if you have any questions, come back. I'm at the end desk. That's my pod. I'm here working on my next piece. So you can come and talk to me privately about stuff if you have questions. I'm completely open to that. So yeah, that's great that we, because we're going totally over time. Yeah, we will. Okay. So as I said, like this is a total jump cut. This is quite a remove from what we've been talking about. But you know, we were all the artists were kind of given a carte blanche to talk to screen a film that either was about performance or in some way related to our practices. And I really, really wanted to screen Love Hard, which is a film by an Australian filmmaker called Garlavanting, and it's a film about BDSM and intimacy. So I really wanted to just kind of throw this in here as a kind of provocation towards opening up the scope of the way we think about these questions of endurance, pain, transformation, all the conversations that have been happening in this building. And especially around, you know, sort of like linking up with performance histories and the way that different performers have used physical pain or endurance as a way to talk about, for instance, cultural trauma, personal trauma, all of this kind of stuff. I'm trying to hammer this into a nutshell now because I know we don't have a lot of time. So I just wanted to kind of reframe those questions in terms of, you know, we've been speaking about it in the context of this residency very much in terms of an art context. And I feel that it's necessary to gesture towards the vast range of other practices and spaces and communities that work with these ideas and work with these practices towards the same ends. So this is a kinky film. And for that reason, we do have to give an adult content warning, or I hate to say it, a trigger warning. This is just an excerpt from the film. Sorry, Julie, were you trying to say something?
No, I was just going to say that I think that in relation to that, it's also about like how a lot of these spaces actually are gestation spaces.
Absolutely.
For artists as well, which I don't think is...
Absolutely.
We don't always talk about.
Yeah, no, completely. That's a really important point. You know, my kind of existence within, say, you know, BDSM spaces and communities or dance parties, subcultural spaces of various forms is like every bit as much of an important influence on my practice as the history of art. So, and these are, you know, things that tend to get marginalised and sidelined and not taken seriously as, you know, as spaces of artistic gestation, but really they're, you know, subcultural spaces are completely, I hate that word, but subcultural spaces are completely entwined with the history of performance, especially in Sydney, so, and in many places really. So yeah, this is just an excerpt from a feature length documentary. So just a 14 minute scene. If you want to see the whole film, I suggest you can rent it online. The title again is Love Hard. This is a really, really beautiful and poignant scene between two BDSM players. It's just a scene, and there's this really lovely text overlaid, which kind of addresses a lot of the themes that we've been talking about around endurance and transformation, but from a very different angle. So I think I'm going to shut up and we're going to roll the film. There's blood, by the way. If you're squeamish about blood, leave.
Take me somewhere.
Oh, close your eyes.
Take me to where the eucalyptus scent softly anesthetizes me, where the ground is so steep that I start to lift out of myself, where the sea sings below us, soft and dangerous. Ferns and moss will witness us. The air is never still, rising and soaring from the sea. Its cold touch exposes us, but burns off in the golden light. A lover, not a slave, I'm ready to receive your marks. I give you my body with full consent. I'm vulnerable, and it is only you, my other, that gives me strength. I hang before you a piece to play with, to make rather than bleed and hurt. I'm giving this to you, letting you see the spaces I go to. What do you see? Do you like what you see? me like some pre-human criminal, dragging me back through my past, through our past, to a time and place where I had not yet been in it. Back in my history, where little germs of possibility start to spread, swelling up in the pit of me, growing tighter with a pleasure painful to hold. I hold it like I hold my breath, and when the blows rain on me too hard to hold, I swell and draw in an exploding cries of pain for your pleasure. Breathe out, breathe in. You can do whatever the fuck you want to me. You can fuck me up how you like. There is a point where I start to lose sense of it all, the point where it starts to make sense. This is the point you're searching for, watching me patiently as I unravel, travelling a knife's edge away from insanity, and not letting me fall into that pit. You reach deep into me with whatever you have to hand, if nothing you fist, reaching in to touch this point where I fall apart and come together. You're there, I am there. The world around us has disappeared, and we huddle together, breathing in each other's warmth, waiting for reality to fill these spaces with rain. Here, in this tiny space, we make the world infinite again. Into the cold dirt, wet with rotting leaves, crawling with the lowest creatures, I sink. Into this void, this pit, this black trench that is opening up in me. My face is wet with tears and mud. My body is breaking. I can do what you ask, just. I can withstand your hits, your kicks, your cold gaze that doesn't love me but calculate its next offense. I can put aside all of what is happening for these moments until you break me over and over, letting me disappear, letting me reform myself. This is why we do it, why we fill you with bitter sensations that I hold until they become something good. What we're doing only makes sense to us.
Thank you.
blood you have opened, wash me clean. You have broken me, you will heal me. Holding me, your warmth, your strength, seeping into the cuts in my flesh, the point from which I start to rebuild. The clocks have started again. The blood stops. The day continues anew. My life is punctuated by the marks you cut into me. As they will heal, I will grow. Your marks, covering my body in a network of silent lines that orbit disappear, trace the contours of my skin stretched out for you. These are the lines of pain you've given me, a pattern in my skin that shows my very fabric. No one can touch me without running their hands over your marks. You are a part of me. This is what I want. I want to be yours, like you are mine. Only you have seen me like this. Only we can play this complicated game of power and resistance and pleasure, of pain and dissociation and trust, of love and destruction and rebirth. You have seen me turn violence into freedom, and blissfully I face the light and draw you closer to me than anyone else would have been. You have seen me stripped to my core, holding on tight to your love that carries me. By destroying me, you bind me to this earth, to yourself. The more you destroy me, the more I exist. Every limit shattered, every horizon expanded, every way you have shown me what I can endure. What we do changes me. It discards my past and lets me live again. This is what we're like. Two sides of a destructive love that keeps us growing for each other. Never still, never neglected. We keep giving everything, for this is all there is. A clean, pure love that exists at the core of us. Is that what you see?
But something has gone wrong with the connection to the main screen, unfortunately, which is a real shame because it takes a lot away from that really, really gorgeous film. If you want to see the whole feature film, Google Love Hard. It's watchable online. And you totally have to get out of the building now because we've gone really out of time. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Another exciting event. It's me. It could be me. Is it me? It's me. That's why I didn't remember. It's the screening of The Colour of Pomegranates by Parajanov. And then, of course, there's other things throughout the day. Thank you so much, Sarah Jane.